So, you want to learn how to play Black Ops 2 Zombies. Why? Seriously, this game came out in 2012. Why the fuck are you playing it now? Anyway, many people don't actually know how to play Call of Duty Zombies. And if you look to the person to your left, and then look to the person to your right, you'll notice that both of them are retards. But one of them is good at COD Zombies. To help you learn how to play, I will be going over the basics, starting off with the first thing that you should do in a game. You should knife all of the zombies on round 1, and then on round 2, shoot them 5 times and then knife them. This will maximize your point gain and start you off in a good place. Now, let's talk about the guns you'll be using. The Second Amendment of the United States Constitution says that we have the rights to bear arms, and goddammit, if you want to survive, you're gonna have to do that. The first guns you should be running into are pistols. Now, pistols have good damage, little to no recoil, but they don't have great ammo capacity. Now, categorizing these weapons, you might find that there are some exceptions to my generalizations, but that will just be from knowledge that you obtain over time. The next guns that you should be running into is either a shotgun or a rifle, and I'm going to talk about shotguns. Shotguns have terrible range, great ammo capacity, and high damage. They're really good at getting you out of a bad spot, but don't do much in the higher rounds. As the rounds get higher, the shotgun will become less and less effective, and you'll be better off switching it out for something such as a rifle. Now, rifles are the most middle-of-the-road pick. They're good overall in stats, and there's nothing special about them. You're gonna want to lean towards these because these should be your bread and butter, except for with one questionable option. There's also submachine guns. These will be lifesavers for you. They have great damage, high rates of fire, and they're great point-making guns, but in later rounds they run out of ammo fairly quickly. Now I'm gonna go over guns that new players should avoid, starting off with LMGs. Now, in the earlier rounds, LMGs can be quite good with their high rate of fire and high ammo capacity. However, you have a very strict movement penalty with it, so learning to train with an LMG isn't always the brightest of ideas. Snipers are hard to wield in close combat, and their fire rate is significantly lower than every other gun, and there's also the problem with the fact that they don't give you a lot of points. There are special weapons that include the ballistic knives and RPGs and the war machine. You will want to avoid these weapons at all costs because most of the time you'll end up downing yourself. They're also not very good for points. Now, you're probably wondering how you buy all these things, and the answer is student loans. Points. Now, the difference between Call of Duty and student loans is that in Call of Duty, you start off with 500 points instead of negative 43,000. You get points by shooting and killing zombies, and through other methods such as repairing barriers, but we don't really do that around here because we don't live in Minneapolis. There are other ways outside of killing zombies that you can get points from, such as from drops or from doing tasks on certain maps. While killing zombies, you will get 10 points for every time you either hit them with a bullet, knife, or a parking ticket if that bitch decides to stay there for more than 2 hours. Killing zombies normally will give you 60 points, however a headshot will give you 100 and a knife kill will be 130. Now, to maximize your points, you're going to want to get headshots and knife kills anytime you see fit. But don't get caught up in your points too much because your life is worth saving more than your points are. You can also double your points with a double points, and if you don't understand how that works, I'm pretty sure you shouldn't even be playing this game in the first place. Drops are very important in this game, and you gotta know what you're actually looking at before you even risk trying to get one, such as getting a max ammo is way more important than getting a carpenter. A carpenter is helpful for the points and not much else, because all it does other than give you points is repair all the barriers on the map. Insta-kills are very helpful because they allow you to get breathing room and also allow you to get easy knife kills for more points. And sorry if this sounds a little bit repetitive because most of the things do what their name implies. Next you have the nuke, and you're going to want to avoid getting this one on low rounds or until you're done setting up. And after you're done setting up, picking up one of these things will help you progress through the rounds a lot faster. They also give you 400 points, so picking them up while there's no zombies around in between rounds is actually a good idea on low rounds. But hey, it's still better than the Black Ops 4 version that completely blinds you when you pick it up.
What did you drop?
last but certainly not least, we have the max ammo, which restores all of your stock ammo and explosives. This does not restore the ammo in your magazine, so try to reload before grabbing it. Now, there are other drops on the game, but they're only on certain maps, and I'll go over that stuff later. With all the points that you'll be getting from killing zombies and getting drops, you'll have to spend it on perks. And let me tell you, this is where the fucking fun begins. There is a shit ton of perks in this game, so I'm just gonna rapid fire through all of them, so let's fucking go. Juggernaut doubles your health, Deadshot Daiquiri makes you auto-aim onto zombies' heads, and you have better hip fire. Double Tap doubles your damage and also increases your fire rate by 33%. Electric Cherry shocks all the zombies around you while you reload. Mule Kick allows you to have 3 guns, and PhD Flopper negates splash damage, fall damage, and also when you dolphin dive, it explodes. This never really works for me, so I don't just fucking do it anymore. Quick Revive on solo allows you to revive yourself and have an extra life. And on multiplayer, you revive other people faster. Speed Cola allows you to reload faster, and Stamina allows you to run faster further, and also negates some of the movement penalty that is on heavy weapons. Tombstone allows you to bleed out on purpose to save all of your stuff, and Vulturade allows you to see where everything is. Zombies drop points and ammo, and also they create safe zones inside of green mists. Who's Who allows you to revive yourself, but you only have a starting pistol, and I know on solo, if you survive long enough, you automatically revive and keep all of your perks. Now that we went through that headache's worth of information, there's an easy way to remember what perks you should get. Just get the same 4 every time until you feel comfortable getting other ones. Got it? Okay, cool. On to the next one. A good word of mind is to get Jug and get Quick Revive as your first 2 perks, because those really help your chances of survival, being that one gives you an extra life and the other one doubles your health. Equipment is the next step, and this includes EMP grenades, monkey bombs, time bombs, the beacon, and the Hell's Retriever, / Hell's Redeemer. The EMP grenade disables perks and zombies, and most likely will get you killed, so do not use this. Monkey bombs distract the zombies, so only use them when you know you're gonna get stuck, or if another player is down. There is another cool strategy that you can do with monkey bombs, and that is if you see a max ammo, throw as many monkey bombs as you can to distract the zombies so you can get it. The max ammo should replenish your monkey bombs, so don't worry about that. The time bomb is just a little too complicated for this video, and the beacon is basically a monkey bomb that just does more damage. And the Hell's Retriever is a tomahawk that hits zombies in a straight line in front of you. The last tool you have to work with is the Pack-a-Punch machine. And this one's pretty simple. 5,000 points, you get a better gun. There are some cool details such as double pack-a-punching to add attachments, but I'm trying to keep this simple. And this is the end goal of your points. This should probably be the last thing that you do. Oh, I almost forgot to talk about wonder weapons. Now every map has wonder weapons, the first being the ray gun, which has great damage but has splash damage. Also, it's by far one of the worst point making guns on early rounds. You might as well use a different gun because the game will just move along a lot slower if you have it. The Mark II is an improvement upon it in every single way, being that it doesn't have splash damage and is a 3 round burst. Next is a Gent gun, which is a buildable wonder weapon, which is really bad and not worth doing, so just don't do it, okay? Next is the Blunder Gap from Mob of the Dead. This is an upgradable shotgun and is a must-have to have fun on Mob of the Dead. I'm not saying Mob of the Dead is bad, I'm just saying that this shotgun is so much fun to use. The Slick Fire on Die Rise is an absolute beast and is a necessary to making Die Rise fun. Be careful though, because it makes the ground slippery and you can fall off the side of the map and die from it. Next is the Paralyzer from Buried. This one's interesting in how it has infinite ammo but runs off a cooldown system. Also, you can fly with it because Treyarch was really running out of ideas to make Victus fun. And lastly, we have the staffs, which are a little bit complicated, but I'm still gonna go over them. I will be referring to them as a whole because they all function very similarly to each other. The staffs are buildable, and the pieces for them are collected in the same way in every game. You're gonna need to look up a full guide and learn how to build them and upgrade all of them because it's just a little too complicated for this video. After building and upgrading all the staffs, there are 3 different abilities that come with them. A normal shot, a charge shot, and a weird red shot. The normal shot will kill zombies and stun them, and if you're playing a drinking game for every time I say zombies, I hope you have health insurance, because you're surely gonna need it. The zombies do this cool thing called pinning your ass to a wall, just like Han Solo, and the staffs are cool because they have a counter for this in the charge shot. This will eviscerate all the nearby zombies, just like the IRS eviscerates all of my money. The weird red shot I was talking about earlier has some pretty cool things about it on how it revives a player if it's down and is basically a one shot. And outside of that, it's not really that useful, but it's there for you to use it. I've been mentioning buildables throughout this video, and what buildables are things that you have to go around the map and find parts for. The most useful one out of them is the shield that prevents you from taking damage to your back and saves you from getting downed tenfold. Other than the shield, there are really two types of buildables, being that there's wonder weapons and there are traps. No, not that type of trap, the other one. After all this, you're probably wondering how you actually play zombies at this point, and well, since you made it to the end of the video, there are two main ways to play zombies. There's camping and there's training. I'm gonna go over camping first because it's really simple, and it's basically just this. Training, on the other hand, is a lot more complicated. It involves running around in a circle to corral the zombies up into one area to shoot them. This takes a lot of practice, and it's going to take some time to get down for you, but a lot of the game revolves around this, and if I was going to give any tips to new players, it would be to use all the room that they have available. Even if it seems like it would trap them, they can still use it to try to get out. And also to watch some other people. There's probably a lot of people online that are much better at training in zombies than I am. So I'll advise you go watch them and see what their strategies are. It's a lot of fun to watch them too. Okay, I'm gonna try to give a training spot and a camping spot for most of the maps, and starting off with transit, for training spots we have in front of the diner and in the town. And for camping, we have the back alleyway in the town, and we also have the bar. Nuketown only has one really good training spot, and that's behind the greenhouse. Mob of the Dead has a camping spot on the gondola, and the best training spot has to be on the bridge. For Dire Eyes, the best training spot is at the bottom of the starting building. And on Buried, the best camping spots have to be in the saloon or by Juggernaut, and the best training spot is just running around the entirety of the map itself. On Origins, there is no camping spots at all, but the good training spots have to be by the tank station, the fifth generator, and also in front of the church. Alright, I hope you found this guide helpful, and hopefully next week you'll be hitting round 50s in no time. And with that being said, zombies. Just for the half of my subscribers to die from alcohol poisoning. See you guys next time!